Oshet Audio presents The Sugar Frosted Nutsack, written and read by Mark Leyner.
There was never nothing. But before the debut of the gods, about 14 billion years ago, things happened without any discernible context. There were no recognizable patterns. It was all incoherent. Isolated, disjointed events would take place, only to be engulfed by an opaque black void, their relative meaning, their significance, annulled by the eons of entropic silence that estranged one from the next. A terrarium containing three tiny teenage girls mouthing a lot of high-pitched gibberish, like Mothra's fairies, except for their wasted pallors, acne, big tits, and t-shirts that read, "I don't do white guys," would inexplicably materialize and then, just as inexplicably, disappear. And then millions and millions of years would pass until, seemingly out of nowhere, there'd be, fleetingly, the smell of fresh rolls. Then several more billion years of inert monotony, and then a houndstooth pattern everywhere for approximately 10 to the negative 37th power seconds, followed by, again, the fade to immutable blackness and another eternal interstice, and then, suddenly, what might be cicadas or the chafing sound of some obese jogger's nylon track pants, and then the sepia-tinged photograph from a 1933 Encyclopedia Britannica of a man with elephantiasis of the testicles. Robots roasting freshly gutted fish at a river's edge. The strobe-like fulgurations of ultraviolet emission nebulae. The unmistakable sound of a koto being plucked. And then a toilet flushing. And this last enigmatic event, the flushing of a toilet, was followed by the most inconceivably long hiatus of them all, a sepulchral interregnum of several trillion years. And, as time went on, it began to seem less and less likely that another event would ever occur. Finally, nothing was taking place but the place. There was a definite room tone, that hum, that hymn to pure ontology. But that was all. And in this interminable void, in this black hyperborean stillness, deep in the farthest flung recesses of empty space, at that vanishing point in the infinite distance where parallel lines ultimately converge, two headlights appeared. And there was the sound, barely audible, of something akin to the Mister Softee jingle. Now, of course, it wasn't the Mister Softee truck whose headlights, like stars light years in the distance, were barely visible. And it wasn't the Mister Softee jingle, per se. It was the beginning of something, a few recursive, foretokening measures of music that were curiously familiar, though unidentifiable, and addictively catchy. Something akin to the beginning of Surrey with the Fringe on Top, or Under My Thumb, or Tears of a Clown, or White Wedding. And it repeated ad infinitum as those tiny twinkling headlights became imperceptibly larger and drew incrementally closer over the course of the million trillion years that it took for the gods to finally arrive. These drunken gods had been driven by bus to a place they did not recognize. It's almost as if they'd been on some sort of spring break, as if they'd gone wild. At first, they were like frozen aphids. They were so out of it, as if in a state of suspended animation. It took them several more million years just to come to, to sort of thaw out. The first god to emerge, momentarily, from the bus was called El Brazo, the arm, also known as Das Unheimlichste des Unheimlichen, the strangest of the strange. He was bare-chested and wore white and Columbia blue polyester dazzle basketball shorts. He would soon be worshipped as the god of virility, the god of urology, the god of pornography, etc. El Brazo leaned out of the bus and struck a contrapposto pose, his head turned away from the torso, an image endlessly reproduced in paintings, sculptures, temple carvings, coins, maritime flags, postage stamps, movie studio logos, souvenir snow globes, takeout coffee cups, playing cards, cigarette packs, condom wrappers, etc. His pomaded hair swept back into a frothy nape of curls like the wake of a speedboat. He reconnoitered the void with an impassive, take-it-or-leave-it gaze, then scowled dyspeptically, immediately turned around, and returned to the bus, where he sullenly ensconced himself, along with the rest of the gods, for another 1.6 million years. It's extraordinary that among these sulking, hungover deities who chose to forever doze and fidget in a bus, there were several with enough joie de vivre to continue beatboxing that hypnotic riff for an eternity, that music that's been so persistently likened to a dance mix of the Mister Softee jingle. Perhaps it was a fragment of their alma mater's fight song. They did act, after all, like classmates, as if they'd grown up together in the same small town. One of the first things the gods did, once they sobered up and finally vacated that bus, was basically put things in order, make them comprehensible, provide context, institute recognizable patterns. The gods imposed coherence and meaning, one suspects, as an act of post-bender penance. And that spot in space where they'd fatefully decamped became consecrated forevermore as the celestial downtown, the capital of a very hip but unforgiving meritocracy. It was very much the Manhattan Project meets Warhol's factory. And there was that chilly vibe of militant exclusivity, that cordon sanitaire, that velvet rope which segregated the gods from everyone and everything else. From the outset, it was clear that these gods had very rigid opinions about who could and who couldn't be part of their exclusive little clique. No socialites, no dilettantes, no one who was merely famous for being famous. Just gods. But their affect was so labile that, depending on your angle, they'd appear completely different from one instant to the next. It was like those lenticular greeting cards. There they'd be, ostensibly a group of elegantly accoutred 18th century aristocrats, straight out of Watteau's Rococo Fête Galante paintings, amorously cavorting in some sylvan glade with the lutes and the translucent parasols and the flying cupids. But if you shifted your vantage point ever so slightly, they'd look exactly like the members of some Japanese noise band smoking cigarettes backstage at all tomorrow's parties at Kutcher's Hotel in Monticello. One minute, they'd have assumed the guise of a bunch of tan, well-heeled, ostentatiously casual CEOs chit-chatting at the annual Allen & Company Sun Valley Media Conference. But then you'd tilt your head a bit, and they'd have metamorphosed into a little army of street urchins with matted hair and yellow eyes scavenging for food in garbage dumps, sucking on bags of glue. And because they were omniscient and so tight.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.